Let us realize, my beloved brothers and sisters, that if we have happiness equal to the day we were married, we say Alhamdulillah, Alhamdulillah. And how can we achieve that? For a moment, let me explain to you. There is something known as khutbatul haja, which is normally read sometimes at the nikah. I'm sure it is the same here in Malaysia. So the imam says, Ya ayyuhan nasu ittaqu rabbakum, O people, be conscious of your maker. الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء. O people, be conscious of your maker who has created you from one soul, and who has created from that soul its spouse, and from the two of you he has caused mankind to spread on earth. وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ, and be conscious of Allah. So if we are conscious of our maker and conscious of the fact that Allah has created for us a spouse from us, and conscious of the fact that we have a duty towards our offspring so that mankind can spread in a dignified manner throughout the earth, and we look at the end of the verse, it says we should be conscious of Allah, the one whose name we use when we take an oath. When someone tells you something that is not so easily believed, say for example, they tell you, you know, I jumped 3 meters. You will say, you look at them, and they say, Wallahi, I jumped 3 meters. Then you start thinking of a trampoline. You know? Because now they're telling you, because initially they made like they just jumped 3 meters going up, wow. Then you start thinking of something, because why? They said, Wallahi. When they use the name of Allah, They take an oath with the name of Allah, it changes the whole flavor of that statement. So Allah says, be conscious of that Allah whose name you use, and be conscious of the wombs that gave birth to you. And not only the wombs that gave birth to you, but the wombs that are used, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created for you to have come into existence and for this progeny to continue. Be conscious, that's your mother. That is your spouse, that is your sister, that is your daughter, that is your aunt. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the true respect of our women. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide our women that they can live their lives in such a way that they earn the respect of those around them. I mean, you know, there are two sides of a coin. We cannot only say that may Allah grant respect to one side without the other. We need respect on both sides. So that is the first verse. Notice I am highlighting consciousness of Allah. If you are conscious of Allah, of your maker, and conscious of the fact that you are going to return to him, and she is conscious of the fact that she is going to return to the maker, at all times, what will go wrong in your marriage? What will go wrong? You find there will be no flirting, there will be no swearing, there will be no fighting. You know, we're fulfilling whatever we have to, and more than that, to the degree that the husband actually says, you know what, Sunday, just sleep. I will bring you breakfast in bed. MashaAllah. Who says that's wrong? Is it wrong? Is it haram to do that? Some people say, no, I'm a Muslim. My wife must make that breakfast. Okay, fair enough. Fair enough. We are not saying that this one or that one, but you want to enhance the love in the home. You might want to sometimes fulfill. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to help with the chores in the house. The messenger, peace be upon him, he assisted milking the goats as well. And you know how tough that is? Allahu Akbar. I think we should go and try it. And people are saying, no, this place is unclean. Look, you haven't hoovered the carpet. No problem. All you've got to do is pick up the hoover and say, no, don't worry, I'll show you how it's done. And show them how it's done. There was once a man who was, this is something that came to my mind because I said I'll show you how it was done, it's not in the topic. There was a man who met me when I was in India, and he told me, you know, I'm a revert, I was a Hindu, and I've accepted Islam, and I am now a muadhin, I call out the adhan, but my adhan is not so good. So the mutawalli of the masjid, you know, the person who is in charge of the masjid, he comes to me every time and says, you don't know adhan. So I said, who is he? So he pointed at a certain man. I said, but brother, do me a favor. In my mind, something crossed me and said, I don't think this brother knows how to do adhan himself. And he is busy shouting someone else. So I told him, brother, next time he tells you you don't know how to do adhan, tell him that do me a favor. You show me how to do the adhan. And however you do, I will repeat it. So what happened is this brother, He told the man that, you know what, okay, you are telling me I don't know how to do adhan. Please, can you just lead the way? Show me once. And I don't want to tell you how it ended. The man was so upset and he realized he didn't know. And it took quite a while to solve that matter, but mashallah, it was solved. The point I'm making is, we need to lead by example. Sometimes we are complaining about dirt in the home. We are complaining that the food is not done properly, but we cannot even fry an egg to save our lives. Yes. And if they say, look, you're saying my food is bad, okay, show me how to cook once, and I will do exactly like that. Wallahi, you just have to say, oh, that was awesome, man. Awesome food, you know? So be reasonable. Think what we are saying. There are some times in the home, and this is also one of the reasons why a home breaks, when we do not appreciate our spouse both ways. The man goes out to work, he wants to earn a living. He comes back, he is tired. Understand him, tell him, look, you know what? I really would like to talk to you and I really would like to spend more time with you, but I think you are very tired, and so understand it. And this is not a green light to the men to say, you know what you heard today? We are tired when we come back from work, so don't talk to me. Don't let that happen. Appreciate that, look, the man has gone out and the man is trying his best. He is the one who has brought in the money that you are able to live in this posh house with. And you have such a vehicle and perhaps a driver and a cook and so on. And then when you have a meal that is made by your wife, remember sometimes it takes long. Some of us are fortunate to have cooks. You need to appreciate them too. But at the same time, in most homes, the spouse cooks the meal. One small thing, we only pick on the negativity. You know, she might get a recipe from her friend. It took her 1 month to get the recipe. Emailing every, please send it. You know, women, I don't know if it's a problem in Malaysia, but they are normally very selfish with recipes sometimes. You say, how was this pie made? They say, oh, you like it? That's my secret. Yes, they don't want to let others know. Wallahi, you take your secret to your grave. Is that okay? Give it to others. Wallah, I know in my own home when something is made, normally I am told, you know, this recipe is from that woman somewhere across the globe. And you say, mashallah. So don't worry, your copyrights will always be appreciated, inshallah, and acknowledged. So she has got the recipe after trying so hard. She came into the kitchen. And what did she do? She got the ingredients. She went to this shop, that shop, this place, that mall. She brought in all the baking items and came in, or the cooking items. And then she got, she perhaps might have bought a specific type of utensil that is needed, or borrowed it or whatever. And a great effort. And she has the meal. And this man is busy at work. When he comes back, it is something that is presented and she is waiting to watch. What happens? When we come in, what's the smell here? The same thing can be said in another way. What's the smell? You see the expression? How it changes the meaning? If I say, what's the smell? It means it's a stink. And if I say, what's the smell? It means it's a scent. How you talk in the home will develop your home. It will protect it from breaking. It will protect it. How you speak, your expressions on your face. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam teaches that to us. The expression means so much. Because we spoke about the smile moments ago. Do you know what a smile does? The other day I saw a message on my phone saying, a smile is a curve that brings everything straight. So it's a curve that brings things straight. It might be correct. It's a curve. We ask Allah to grant us goodness. These expressions, we are very fast. We are very, very fast when it comes to expressions of the face, on the face with outsiders. Come home and it changes. Look at yourself in the mirror. Have a little CCTV in the house by the door and see what you look like. Watch your own movie. Look at it. And then tell myself, why is my home breaking? Well, you know what? Just watch your movie. And then watch the real movie and see those who are not married pretending to be husband and wife in a movie. What they do sometimes is, you know, far deeper than anything really married people have done. Allah protect us. Obviously, we are not, you know, encouraging people to go into the nakedness and so on. But what we are saying is we are all guilty of knowing the depth of, you know, the Hollywood and Bollywood and so on, and what all that we have, in the sense that even that which we ourselves are guilty of destroying within our homes, we watch others mending and we don't even learn from that which is wrong. Allahu Akbar, I don't know if you understand what I'm saying. If we cannot learn from qala Allahu wa qala Rasul, and we cannot learn from others who are enjoying a happy life, then it's all over. Then it's finished. Because if you see others leading a happy life, you learn from them, number one, then you will come to realize that, but the messenger, peace be upon him, has something more than that. I have explained in one of my talks that, you know, Aisha radiallahu anha describes how the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was romantic in his home to the degree that he used to drink water from exactly the spot where she drank from, and he would watch her to see that she is watching. Some of us are too big to do that in the home. I am too high in my business or in wherever, or you know, I am too high in the religious rank to actually do that. And when we go to the meat that was eaten once, there is a narration which says that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam watched where she bit from, this is his wife, and he took it and rolled it to where she had bitten from and bit exactly where she bit from. Tell me what Valentine's Day can come up with. Nothing. That wife will melt, she'll faint, we need assistance. Allahu Akbar. We'll need assistance. And that is something Islamic. We're talking of Islam. So if people say Islam and romance are two separate items, that's not true. Islam is a religion, but we are taught to be romantic with the right people. That's what we are saying. Today we can be romantic with all the others. Come home, everything is gone. This is the problem. So Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us, when we begin to see how he lived, there was a time when he took his wife and they were at a specific place and he decided, look, I want to race with you. I want to see who's going to beat who here. And he raced with her. The first time she won and the second time he won, later on in life and so on. So these are the type of things that have been happening at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is according to his time. It was considered something very grand in his time. So sometimes with us, nowadays a little rose has a lot of value. What's wrong if a person who's a big businessman, you know, comes with a rose hidden behind his back and he comes and suddenly presents it to a wife whom he's been married to for 30 years. Anything wrong? Islam doesn't say it's prohibited, especially if it's on an ordinary day of the year. No one will tell you anything. Or your wife might say, who gave that to you? It might happen, yes. That might happen. Because she will probably be shocked. Allah protect us. We need to develop. It's not so difficult, but we are guilty of being, of drowning in our lives without looking at those who are the closest to us. Those who are the closest to us. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has taught us so much, yet we don't even know. Getting back to the verses that are read at the time of nikah, even the next verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu taqullaha. O you who believe, be conscious of Allah. Be conscious of your maker. And this verse is repeated at the time of marriage. It's khutbatul haja. It is a khutbah that is often repeated for most important items. And the next verse, the last one. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu taqullaha. It starts in the same way. O you who believe, be conscious of your maker at all times. Know that you are going to return to him. So in this, you have someone whom you are married to. She is also the sister of someone. She is also the daughter of someone. She is also the relative of someone. She is very special and dear to her family members. And you need to know you have taken her into your custody, so to speak, or in your care. Respect her and honor her and fulfill her rights. And where she is going wrong, there is a method of communicating with her, of letting her know. And that brings me to the last part of this third verse, where Allah says, وَقُولُوا قَوْلًا سَدِيدًا. Utter that which is upright. Utter that which is straight. Sadid means straight. Make sure that you are conscious of your maker and you only utter that which is upright. Because 90% of marital problems are connected to how you use your mouth. We have not been able to use it correctly. There is a drought when it comes to good words. And there is a flood when it comes to swear words. That's what's happening today. We have a drought of good words. And our mouths are flooding with bad words. Swearing in the house. Screaming, yelling. When you raise your voice in the home, your value is dropped forever. If you yell at your wife once in her face, sorry, I need to say it the other way around. If you yell at your husband once in his face, it's over. You know, we used to talk about wife bashing until I got so many emails saying, brother, we are bashed by our own wives. It's husband bashing now. Allahu Akbar. So it's important for us to know, either way, respect one another. Understand one another. Speak to one another in a beautiful manner. Make sure you know this tongue. You need to say words to your spouses and your children of reassurance. You love your child. Let him hear it every day. Every single day. The next time he wants to do something bad, he say, you know what, my dad really loves me and I don't want to let him down. I really don't want to. This is not worth it.